So hello everyone.
We are gathered today to listen to the PhD defense of Thibaut Munzer. And so the jury is composed of six members. There will be Estelle Adico, who is a professor at the University of Bignot and who is present through Skype here. So hello Estella, I don't know if you are hearing us.
Yes.
There is Mr. Joao Diaz. I'm not sure I am pronouncing you right.
Joel.
Okay. Joel, okay. From the Department of Instituto Superior Técnico in Portugal. David Danet, who is a research scientist at INRIA. Mohamed Chetwani, who is a professor at University of Pierre-Emmanuel Curie in Paris. Manuel Lopez, who is a director of the PhD of Thibaut Munzer. And so I will be the president of the jury, and I am research director at INRIA. And so, Thibaut, we are hearing for you. You have 45 minutes.
So good morning, everyone. Thanks for being here. Today I will talk about the work I did during my PhD, which is titled Rational Representation and Interactive Learning for Efficient Cooperative Behavioral Learning. I will start with a short introduction, then I will review the different design choices we made and the thesis plan we came with. In the third part, I will describe the different algorithmic contributions we arrived during this PhD, and I will finish with the robotic application and the discussion. Robot, in the sense of tools controlled by algorithm and whose behavior-dependent sensor, have quickly found industrial application after the development in research laboratory. For a long time, their improvements were mostly focused on speed, strength, and precision, and as a consequence, become dangerous for human because a human could get harmed if he were in the trajectory of the robot. So, human workspace and robot workspace were separated, and the robot were put in cages. Today, this is changing thanks to a new trend in robotics, the cobot trend. Cobot is a portmanteau word made from the words collaborative and robotics. And the idea is that robots are present and strong, while humans are adaptable and smart. And so by creating a team composed of a human and a robot, we could get the best of both worlds. Today, cobots are mostly power tools, which are mounted on robotic arms, in order for the human to manipulate the tools as is a lightweight. The interest in this PhD was to give more initiative to the robot, so they will become more intelligent tools and they would be able to better support the human. This is especially relevant for small series industry. Because for big series industry, it will forever be cheaper just to hire a team of roboticists and ask them to take care of to build robotic chains that will take care of the production from end to end. However, for small series industry, this is not possible because it's too expensive, and so this kind of solution can be of interest. This is a complicated problem, and we restrict ourselves on one part of it. This is a standard architecture for robotic agents, composed of three modules. The first one, perception, is responsible to transform the raw sensorial inputs into an inner representation called the state. The second module is responsible, based on this state, to select a high-level action to do. And the last one, the motion planner, transforms this high-level action into motor commands. In this PhD, we'll be focusing on the decision-making module. So, as I said, our goal is to work toward semi-autonomous collaborative robots. And we want this robot to have a number of properties. First, we would like it to generalize to similar scenario. For example, if a new assembly step is required, we would want the robot to be able to reuse previous knowledge, not to start from zero. If the color of an object changes, we would want the robot to be able to accommodate to that without relearning from everything, not from the start. The second property is we would like the programming of the behavior of the robot to be intuitive. So in the future, it could be done by the end user. The third property we would like is to use data efficiently. We don't want the robot to be able to acquire a behavior after 1,000 steps, when maybe it will be only the assembly plan will only be used by 100 steps, because it will never be useful if it takes too long to learn to get the behavior. And the last point is we would like to learn the behavior at the team level, so the robot could predict what the human will do. And this is again looking for the future, so we could do interesting things like team switching, where the role switching, excuse me, where the robot takes the place of the human, the human takes the place of the robot, or we could change the geometry of the action in order to take into account what the human is going to do next, and this kind of things. So I will now describe the design choice we made in order to meet these four properties. For the first one, in order to have a behavior that generalizes to similar scenario, we must model the behavior somehow, and we decided to use the Markov decision process framework, as this is the more used framework for this kind of modeling. And we also decided to use a relational version, a relational representation, because this kind of representation are shown that they can transfer. This kind of representation are really good at transferring, and in particular, they can naturally transfer to different number of objects. So you can add an object in the scene, and the robot will still be able to act. And this is the kind of representation that is used by the planning community to model high-level generic plan. So I will quickly describe the Markov decision process on their rational version. MDP is composed of four things: state space, action space, transition function, and reward function. A policy is what models the behavior of the robot. It can be either a deterministic mapping from state to action, or a stochastic mapping from state to a distribution over the action. And the idea is that the environment produces a state, the agent based on this policy produces an action, and then based on this state and action, the environment produces a new state with the transition function and the reward with the reward function. The last equation is the Q function equation or the Bellman equation, and it's the quality function represents the expected reward an agent will get by following a policy. So for relational MDP, the states are represented with logical predicates. And for example, if you want to represent this figure as rational, and we have three predicates: on, which means a block is on top of something else, an object is on top of something else; clear, which means there is nothing on top of this object; and block, which means this object is a block. We'll use the following representation, which means the block 1 is on top of the block 2, the block 3 is on top of the table, the block 3 is on top of the table, there is nothing on top of block 1, and so on. In this kind of version of the MDP, transition rules are also represented with logic, and in particular logical rules. So here there are three rules for the block swap represented just on top of the slide, and they all represent the move action. In these rules, the capital letter represents a variable, which means it should be substituted in order to apply the rules. The first line of the rules is the name of the action and its parameter. The second line is the context. So when we substitute the variable by identifier of object, this should be true in order for the action to be realizable. If this is not contained in the state, we cannot apply the action. And the last line is the outcome of the action. It's how the state change when we apply the action. And so we have different rules because based on the context, the outcome will be different. So this diagram illustrates the transition function. We start from a state with its given rational representation. Then we have a number of actions depending on how we were able to substitute the context. The context for an action to be realizable, the context in blue must match the state. And if this action is selected, we apply the outcome parts by removing the predicate in red and adding the predicate in green. So now for the second property, intuitive behavior programming, we decided to use the learning from demonstration paradigm. And formally, this paradigm represents a kind of problem where, as input, you have a data set composed of couple, and in each couple there is a state and the action an expert chooses in this state. And the goal of learning from the illustration is from this data set to produce a policy that that drives over the expert behavior. This data set can be built by different means. It can be built from demonstration of human realizing the task. It can be built with instruction. It can be built with feedback, or it can be built with other means. And as long as we are able to build such a data set, we can use LFD tools in order to learn the behavior. And this is why we decided to use this paradigm. It's because for us, it would be easy to construct such a data set based on instruction and feedback from the user. There are two main family of algorithms for learning from demonstration. The first one is imitation learning. In that case, we consider the problem of LFD as a supervised classification problem, and we treat the state as example and the action as labels. And so we can use any tools for standard classification in order to produce the policy. And the second family is the inverse response learning, or IRL. And in that case, we make the assumption that the user is optimizing for latent reward, and the goal of the IRL is to find this reward. It uses for this the expert data set and the transition function, the state space and the action space. Once we have a reward, we still need to transform it to a policy. So the IRL algorithm needs a second step, which can be either reinforcement learning or optimal control. The big advantage of imitation learning is that it doesn't require the transition function, and in practical case, transition function is often hard to model and hard to learn. So in those cases, it can be interesting to use imitation learning. And for IRL, the advantage is that it generalizes better. In the extreme case where states are only represented with identifier, the imitation learning will not be able to generalize at all. Whereas reinforcement learning, by using information contained in the transition function, will still be able to model the behavior. However, inverse reinforcement learning algorithms are computationally expensive, both because the algorithms for IRL are usually expensive, and because of the second step, which is also computationally expensive. So, in the literature, there is not much regarding LFD in rational domain. For imitation learning, there is one algorithm, which is Tevril. I will talk about it just after. And for IRL, there is no algorithm. So we decided we wanted to develop an IRL algorithm for MDP, so we could compare the two and see how the trade-off between the two algorithms works with rational representation. Is it worth it to learn the reward or not? So the Tevril algorithm treats the imitation learning problem as an optimization problem. It defines a loss that has to be optimized, which is the log likelihood of the expert data set. But since the policy by itself it's hard to optimize because there is some constraint, it must be a probability distribution. They also define a smooth mapping between policy and function. And then they use gradient boosting to find a Q function that minimizes the loss. The gradient boosting algorithm is equivalent to standard gradient descent, except it doesn't find a vector that minimizes a function, but it finds a function that minimizes a functional. And in order to do this, the idea is to compute the gradient on a set of input points of the function, and then to use a weak learner to generalize to the whole support of the function. And since we're working with rational representation, in Tevril, they propose to use rational regression trees. These are equivalent to traditional regression trees, both in terms of inference and learning. The main difference being that in the nuts, it's not a test over the feature that decide which path to take, but a logical query that if it's true, we take one path. If it's not true in the state, we take the other path. So, we will not talk about the first property, the fact we want to use data efficiently. For this, we propose to use interactive learning. The idea behind interactive learning is that there is no separate training and exploiting phase. The robot is constantly trying to to exploit what is already learned to predict what to predict something, and he is always training when new data is available. So the goal here is the robot is useful from the beginning. And another advantage of interactive learning is that the user doesn't have to choose the dataset size, which is often a parameter that is hard to pick when the person that picks it doesn't have a deep understanding of the inner mechanism of the solution. So we decided to make a second algorithmic contribution, which will be to create an interactive learning architecture for collaborative robots. And for the last property, to learn the behavior at the team level, we decided to rely on concurrent domain, so multiple actions can be done at the same time, concurrently. So we could model human and robots in the same process. Another advantage of this approach is that if the robot has two arms, he will be able to move both arms at the same time, and so to better help the user. And so we decided to make a third algorithmic contribution, which would be to apply LFD tools in concurrent domain. These are the main paper her work is based on. The first one by Natarian and all is the Tebrin paper. I just speak about the Tebrin algorithm, which do learning from demonstration in rational domain. The second one is a paper, Confidence-Based Autonomy, by Chernova and Veloso, which have proposed an architecture for interactive learning from demonstration. And the architecture I will present later is inspired from this. And then the three last papers are papers that that democratize approach. And in particular, we have the co-articulate action model by Juan Imanesh and Mai Devan, which democratized the approach to use concurrent Markov decision process. There is a relational reinforcement learning paper by Zerosky, which democratized learning in rational MDP. And finally, there is the inverse robot learning paper by Abidan and G that proposed the inverse robot learning formulation and the first approach to it. So to sum up the plan of the thesis, we decided to make three main algorithmic contributions. The first one is to create an algorithm, a higher algorithm for RMDP. The second one was to apply learning from demonstration tools in concurrent domain. And the last one was to create an interactive architecture for the collaborative robots. We also decided to validate the approach. And to do this, we had two main points. First, we wanted to implement the approach on a robot to verify by yourself that it's working. And the second one was to conduct a user study to validate that naive user can use the system. So I will now detail the three algorithmic contribution we made. The first one was the development of a higher algorithm for a rational domain. And to do this, we decided to start from an already existing propositional algorithm named Cascade Supervised IRL, or CSI. And the idea behind this algorithm is to decompose the IRL problem in two parts. First, finding a Q function that explains the expert data sets, and second, finding a reward that corresponds to this Q function. A Q function that corresponds that explains the expert data sets is a Q function for which, for any input, for every couple in the input data set, the action the expert picked will have a higher quality than any other action, and this formulation is equivalent to score-based classification. And for the second step, by inverting the Bellman equation or function equation, we can cast it as a regression problem. So the first contribution was to apply this to under rational data, to transform this to under rational data. For the first step, the score-based classification step, we use gradient boosting with as we learn our rational trees and as functional likelihood of expert data, which is equivalent to Tebrin. And for the second step, we use rational regression trees. While developing this algorithm, we encounter a problem. And the problem is the following. We represent reward with trees, And so in the reward space, there will be rewards that are harder or easier to represent with such trees. Because to represent a function with trees, it must have a certain shape. And so since there is a one-to-one correspondence between optimal q-function space and reward space, if during the first step we learn a q-function that corresponds to a reward which is hard to optimize, we will not be able to get good results. So our second contribution in that specific project was to find a way to transform the q-function before doing the regression, such that the regression will be easier. To do this, we use the reward shaping theory. Reward shaping is used to transform a reward, but keeping to find a reward that is different from the original one, but by while keeping the optimal behavior. So we change the reward, but the optimal behavior stays the same. And in particular, it states that you can add to a Q function any function that depends only on the state, and it will not change the optimal behavior represented by this Q function. So what we did is we used an optimization algorithm to find a Q function such that it represents to a reward easy to represent, and we model this using a heuristic criterion. So I will now talk about the evaluation we did on this algorithm. We evaluate this algorithm in simulation on a 5-block swirl. So the block swirl is the kind of world I presented earlier with blocks that you can move around. The goal was to learn a behavior that solved the stack task, where all the blocks have to be on top of each other. And since this was the first IRL algorithm for rational domain, we compared it to an imitation learning algorithm, which is Tebrain. And these are the results. On this axis, there is the number of expert episodes, so the size of the training datasets, the expert dataset, excuse me. And on this axis, it's a measure of quality. And in red, it's RCSI, in blue, it's Tebrain. As you can see, RCSI is slightly superior. And in green, there is RCSI without the intermediary step of reward shaping. And as you can see, the reward shaping step is necessary in order to achieve good results. This is the second set of results I will present on this algorithm. In the previous results, as I said earlier, to go from reward to policy, you have to apply either optimal control or constant learning. And in the previous result I shown, it was optimal control. We used value iteration, and so we optimized offline. But it can also be done online while we're using reinforcement learning. And this is what we do here. So here is the time, the number of times the robot realized the task. Here is the quality. And after 50 epochs, we change the dynamics of the world. We make one of the cube not movable anymore. So it modeled if the cube was sleepy and the robot was not able to take it anymore. And as expected, Tebrain cannot recover from that change because it directly learned the behavior. While Tebrain, by learning the reward, so the goal of the behavior, is able to recover and find a new behavior that solved the task. So our second goal in this PhD was to develop a way to use learning from demonstration in concurrent domain. What we did was to develop the relational activity process, or RAP, which is a concurrent domain, and then we could apply LLD tools in it. The main idea behind RAP is to split the action notion in standard NDP in two things: a decision and an activity. A decision is the conscious judgment to start an action, while the activity is the execution of the action. And so the decision in that case can be either start an activity or a special weight decision, or a special weight decision. And so this stays sequential. The decision process stays sequential. We take a decision, then we take another decision, and so on. But in order to have concurrent activity, the activities are embedded in the state, so we keep the Markov property, and we're still in MDP. So as for standard rational MDP, we use logical rules to represent the transition function. Here are the rules for a concurrent version of the block swarms. where two arms cooperate to, I mean, two arms have a behavior that cooperate to achieve some goals. And now there is two activities, there is a pick activity and a put activity. So the first one is the pick, and the two last rules represent the put activity. And so before the transition, when we applied the transition, the action was realized and the outcome was the realization of the action. Whereas here, the decision is only starting an activity. So as a result, the transition will simply be adding a go predicate, which represents the running activity, in the state. And this go predicate is real values, real value to represent the time the activity will take to achieve. There is also a special waiting decision. And the wait decision is when the activity are realized, when the real time advance. There is a special procedure that is applied. First, it selects in the state the go predicate with the least time to go. It removes this value to any other predicate to make real time advance. And then it replaces this go predicate with a terminate predicate. And there are another set of rules, termination rules. So this model the end of an activity. Before it was the start of an activity, now it's the end of the activity. There are different rules for pick and for put. Once again, the context is used to produce different results based on the state. And yeah, so these actions are applied at the end of the activity. Because this the decision process stays sequential, we can directly use learning from demonstration tools. In that case, there is two agents. So the two agents are the two arms of the robot. There is still five blocks in the world, and the goal is still to make a tower with the blocks. And these are the results. So once again, this axis represents the number of the size of the training data sets, and this axis measures some measure of success. And as you can see, with enough training data, both algorithms manage to learn concurrent plan in this representation. So the last algorithmic contribution was the design of this architecture for interactive collaborative robots. And the idea was to start from an empty data set, then to get the state from the environment. We ask predictor that predicts what's the next action to give us the next action and an associated error. And then based on if it's a robot activity or not, we do different things. In the first time the robot is used, the predictor is not yet learned. And so we will simply always return human activity. So if it's a human activity, the transition will be applied, and we will open. The robot will be potentially receiving feedback. There can be two kinds of feedback. If the robot predicted the correct activity, it will be a validation feedback, and if the robot predicted the wrong activity, it will be a modification feedback. And there can be two ways to get the feedback. The first one is implicit. If the robot predicted the human activity, he can, by observing the human, know if he were wrong or right. It doesn't need any. There is no need for the human to explicitly do something. However, if what the robot should have done is a robot activity, there need to be an explicit feedback where the user tells the robot, "I wanted you to do this." Then we add the new training data to the data set. We update the state and we look back to predicting the next decision. In the case where it was a robot activity, we compare the predicted error to the threshold. If this error is inferior to the threshold, we ask the user, should I do this? So we ask before acting if it's the correct action to do, the correct activity. Then we apply the activity, we add to the data set, and we look back. But if the error is inferior to the threshold, which means the robot is confident about its choice, then it will start the activity and then wait for feedback. If it were wrong, the human can tell after it started, no, this is not what you should have done. In that case, if the user has to say it's not what you should have done, it's a new type of feedback, it's a correction feedback. Once the task is solved, we learn we relearn the predictor, and we are ready to start the task again. We only learn the predictor once every time the task is finished because it will be too expensive to do it each time, and we could not do real time if we learn the predictor after each decision. For an interaction to be successful, we want two things. First, we want to avoid correction feedback because this corresponds to an error the robot makes. And second, we want to avoid as much as possible explicit feedback because it means the user have to make the conscious decision to tell the robot you should not have done this. It asks more to the user explicit feedback than implicit feedback. And these two quantities are a trade-off. We can reduce the number of correction we can even put the number of corrections to zero by putting this threshold at zero, but in that case we will have more explicit feedback. And we can do the inverse by putting this threshold high, but we will have more correction, less explicit. And depending on the task at end, this trade-off can be different. For example, if we are in a critical application where things can get broken or people can get harmed, we want to have as less correction as possible. However, if it's a situation where an error is not really that bad, we maybe want more error so the robot can learn faster. In this slide, I consider that we have a predictor that can give us the best action, but also the associated error. I will now present how we compute this associated error. So we started from a simple idea. If we learn a number of models, for example 50, we can see how this model agrees in order to have an idea of how sure the robot is. So here we have the function that will select the activity and return the associated error. It takes as input the states on the list of models, for example 50. Then for every decision, it will compute the associated error. So it creates a counter, and for every it loops over the model, and each time a model thinks this action is not optimal, it will add one to the counter. Then it creates a list of all the error. We pick the minimum error, and we return the corresponding action and the corresponding error. However, the models give us more information than just what's the optimal action. They give us an approximation of the quality of each decision. So we can take that into account in order to have a better estimation of the reward. And this time, in place of simply counting one each time a model disagrees, we add to the error the distance between the current decision and the optimal decision for this model. And the last thing we did regarding this algorithm, in our case, there is often multiple paths that lead to the completion of the task, which means in most states, there is more than one optimal action. And we wanted to take that into account. So in place of looping over all decisions, we loop over all subset of the decision set. And for each subset, we will evaluate the potential error and return the optimal subset. To estimate the potential error of a subset, we simply simply compute how much we should change the prediction vector such that every decision in P will be optimal. And to do this, we cast this problem as a quadratic convex optimization problem, and we use an off-the-shelf solver to solve it. We experimented we evaluated this algorithm, in simulation once again. This time we have two agents, one which is a simulated human, and the other one is a simulated robot. There is still five blocks in the world, and the goal is still to make a tower with the blocks. So as I said earlier, the number of error and the number of explicit feedback the user gives the robot is a trade-off. There is no one good answer. Like, you cannot say, okay, the robot should never make any mistake, and you cannot say the robot should give as few explicit as possible. It's really depending on the situation. So we wanted to compare for any situation the interactive architecture with a batch approach. Here, the circles are all interactive with different value of the threshold, so different value for this trade-off. And all the square are batch version. And to play on this trade-off with for the batch approach, we change the number of demonstrations. Because if we give few demonstrations to the robot, it means we give few explicit instructions, but the robot might make more mistakes. If we give a lot of demonstration to the robot, it means we give more instruction to the robot, but the robot should make less mistakes. So these two parameters are a bit equivalent in the two approach. And the interesting thing here is that for any square, you can find a circle that make less error on require less instruction. So it means that no matter what the trade-off is, we can always find a version of the interactive that will be better in both of the criterion we are interested in. The second graph presents an advantage of a rational representation. It illustrates an advantage of rational representation. And what we did here is we trained a robot to do a simulated user trained a robot to help him build a stack of 5 blocks for 10 tiles, so for 10 stack. And then after 10, we add a block to the domain. So there was 5 blocks, now there is 6, and the goal is still to make a tower with the 6 block. And we have two different curves. The blue one transfer, the robot reuse the knowledge he acquired during the first 10 step. And green, it erases this knowledge, it doesn't take into account, it starts back from zero. And as you can see, the transfer makes less mistakes and less error. And so it means the robot is capable to relatively well transfer its behavior from a 5-block world to a 6-block world. And this is something not shown here, but this is really hard to achieve with a propositional representation. You need a very specific design of your representation in order to accommodate for change in the number of objects in the scene. Whereas for rational representation, it can do it naturally. So I will detail the robotic application. This is the task we consider. We wanted the task which is closer to reality. So in this task, the user with the help of the robot must assemble a toolbox. There is 5 parts: side front, side back, side left, side right, and handle. These two parts can be switched, and these two parts can be switched, which means there is a lot of ways to assemble the box. The human is responsible to screw. At the beginning, all the pieces are out of reach of the human, so the robot must bring them to him. And the robot is equipped with 4 activities: pick and give that allow to give the piece to the human, hold that helps the human screwing, and go home which put the back in front position. Pick and give are done with the left arm of the robot, while hold is done with the right arm of the robot. And this is the robotic implementation. We get information about the real world through an OptiTrack system that tracks the wrist of the human, the position and rotation of the object, and the position of the screwdriver. Based on this, we have 2 modules, perception modules that create the state based on this OptiTrack information, and the human recognizer that recognizes the human action. And they feed this to the interaction controller, the architecture I presented before. The interaction controller also exchange with the GUI to ask user questions and get answers. The interaction controller create the dataset and use the model from the learning from the demonstration. And then there is the last module, a motion planner, that transforms this high-level action into motor command. All the modules in red were specifically coded for this application, for this task. And if we want to change task, we would have to recode them because they were hard-coded to handle this specific action, this specific state, and so on. So I will now present you the results. Here are the setup. So the pieces are here at the beginning, out of reach of the human. And on the right of the screen, there is the interface that is presented on this tablet, and the human used to instruct the robot. So during the first assembly, the human will always instruct the robot for every action. Robot doesn't take initiative. At the bottom of the screen, there are the different activities the robot is currently running. On the left for the right arm, on the right for the left arm. And as you can see, the robot can make more than one activity at once, thanks to the computer domain. And so the user will instruct every activity until the task is realized. Once this is done, the robot will learn a model, and then it can begin to be useful. And here you can see the robot, before the question were blue, this is green, and this means the robot is sure about himself. And so we start the activity, and then the human can give feedback. But the robot will do the activity no matter what, just for the future. It's clearly feedback in that case, not instruction. And so when it's green, it means the user was sure and started the action, the activity. And so the user doesn't have to use the tablet in that case. Sometimes the robot will not be sure, and in that case, it will ask the question, should I do this? The ask before act the condition, and this will be a red question. For example, here. Sorry. Okay, this is my point. I will now quickly describe the user study we made. There were two conditions, instructed and semi-autonomous. In the instructed condition, the user instructed the robot for the whole task. So each activity they wanted the robot to make, that to instruct the robot. And for the semi-autonomous, we used the approach we presented before. There were 10 subjects, mean age of 30, and they self-reported an experience with robotics at 3.1 on a scale from 1 to 5. These are the results. In each condition, they made 3 assembly of the toolbox consecutive. three assembly of the toolbox. Here are the number of times they used the interface, and here are the number of actions the robot made. So for both conditions, the robot made the same number of actions, which means they used the robot in both conditions approximately the same. But in the green condition, so the semi-autonomous, the interactive approach, the number of interactions with the tablet is decreasing strongly to end up at 7 when it started around 18. And we also asked questionnaires to the user after each condition. Here I highlighted interesting results. In the semi-autonomous condition, the user thought the robot was a better coworker, and they also thought that the robot makes the task easier. And here a second set of results. In both conditions, they were not really afraid to work with the robot, but in the semi-autonomous condition, they were a bit more afraid, while at the same time, the behavior of the robot was much closer to the expectation. Which means these two quantities, being afraid of the robot and having a behavior that corresponds to the expectation, are not really related and should be taken into account when designing this kind of system. I will finish with the discussion. First, a list of the contributions we made in this PhD. The first one was to develop an IR algorithm for action domain. Then we adapted learning condensation tools to work in RAP. We developed a method to estimate the potential error when multiple optimal choices are present. We designed an interactive learning architecture for collaborative robots. We make a robotic implementation of this architecture. And we conducted a user study to validate it. In the robotic application, we never used RCSI, and there are two reasons for that. The first one is that it's computationally too expensive and cannot run in real time. I mean, even if we only learn the models once for every task, RCSI can take up to an hour with the two step, so it's not possible. And the second one is that we discover a weakness of the algorithm, specifically in the second step. In this step, we optimize a vector using a gradientless approach, where the size of the vector depends on the number of unique states in the dataset. And when we tried to use it in this application, either the size of the dataset was too small and we could not get good results, or the size was too big and the optimization phase didn't work anymore, and so we get bad results also. So further research is needed to see if we can either modify this step or change something else in the algorithm to work there. There are two main directions for future works. The first thing I should say is that we think today the motion planner module, excuse me, let me start again. When I presented the scope of the thesis, I said we only consider this part, but for the what we propose to be usable in a wide variety of tasks, these two parts should also be usable by your user. Be trainable by user. User should be able to create them. For the last part, we think today it's realistic to expect a user to teach the kind of activity we used in this work, based on learning from demonstration and motion planning and a good interface. Okay. However, we could, as a future direction, couple more these two modules, and so the decision making could use information. Sorry, the motion planner could use information from decision making. Because decision making knows what's the next action of the human, the motion planner could take that into account to optimize the geometry to help better the user. For example, if the user is going to pick something with his left hand, maybe it's better to put it near his left hand than the right hand. And the second direction is regarding the perception module. As I said today, it's really complicated to design such a module for a naive user. Even for an expert, it can take a few iterations. And so one way to use this approach in a real setup will be to have a robot that is able to, by himself, find a correct perception. This is a hard research problem to find, to learn symbols. But we think it can be made simpler by taking into account the task, not looking for symbols that represent the world well, but symbols that allow to learn the task well. And in particular, it could use learning signal coming from the decision. We could have an approach here that use learning signal from the decision module in order to find such representations that allow to learn the task. That allow to learn representations that allow to learn the task. Thank you.